Well, good morning. Wonderful to see you here today. We're so glad that you've come and set aside time this morning to come and to worship with us. Look forward to this week. We start back choir orchestra rehearsals on Wednesday night, which means next week the choir and orchestra return to services, and we're excited about that. Everybody enjoys a little time off, but by now they're itching and ready to start again, and that's a good thing. Let's stand together this morning, and let's sing and worship the King of Kings together today.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Thy bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light. It streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Frail children,
be seated.
I want to welcome you to First Baptist Conroe today. We're delighted that you're here this morning to join us in worship as we sing together, fellowship together as a church family. And then in just a few minutes, Pastor Jeff will be here to continue his series, Urgency, looking at the letters to the church in Revelation. So we're excited about that. Great start to that series last week. Hopefully, you know that tonight, First Baptist Conroe has rented out the Conroe Aquatic Center. Water slides, swimming pool, all kinds of fun. Pizza will be there. Fun for all ages. If you want to, maybe your inner child wants to come out and go down a water slide, you can come and be a part of that. Bring your kiddos, your grandkids. Come out tonight at 6:30 to the Conroe Aquatic Center and come have some fun with us as we close out the summer with a bang. I do have to give a little bit of a caveat to that, though. We have scheduled this event several years in a row, and some of those years it rains that event out. So about 6:30 tonight, if you're not able to make it, say a prayer that it doesn't rain so those of us that are there get to enjoy it. But just at 6:30 tonight, the rest of the day, it can rain all day. If you're our guest, you're invited tonight as well, but we'd like to ask that you would do something for us this morning. Just let us know that you were here today. There's a QR code on the screen behind you. You can scan that with your smart device or go straight to fbcconroe.org/contact. Fill that out. Let us know that you were here with us so that we can reach back out to you this week and say thank you for choosing to be here. And then each one of you, if you've got something that you want us to be praying for as a church staff, you can use the QR code that's on the pew rack right there in front of you. That will take you to our prayer card, also a link to our sign up for our newsletter and find out more information about things that are happening in the life of our church. Before we sing some more together, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that you've given us to be here today. Thank you for the respite that you've given our choir and orchestra, but we look forward to them being back on stage and leading us in worship in the weeks to come. And I thank you for the opportunity that you give us today to sing praise to you as a church family, to fellowship around the name of Jesus, to be equipped to be the men and women that you have called us to be. And so I pray that you would sharpen us today, open our hearts to what you had to say to us, and help us to be obedient to you in all that we do. We give you this time this morning, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand together and continue to sing this morning. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story. this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. I'm watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. And when peace like a attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well. Well, came to you with my heart in pieces and found the God with healing in his hands. I turned to you, put everything behind me, and found the God that makes all things new. I look to you, drowning in my questions, and found the God who holds all wisdom. I trusted you and stepped out on the ocean. You caught my hand among the waves, 'cause you're the God of all my days. Each step you're the God of all my days. I ran from you and wandered in the shadows and found a God who relentlessly pursued. I hid from you, haunted by my failures, and found the God whose grace still covers me. I fell on you when I was at my weakest, and found the God, the lifter of my head. And I've worshipped you and felt you right beside me. You're the reason that I sing, 'cause you're the God of all my days. Each step I take, you make a way, and I will give you all my praise. My you're the God of all my days. In my worry, God, you are my stillness. In my searching, God, you are my answers. In my blindness, God, you are my vision. In my bondage, God, you are my freedom. And in my weakness, God, you are my power. You're the reason that I sing, 'cause you're the God of the God of all my days. In my blindness, God, you are my vision. In my bondage, God, you are my freedom. All my days.
there's a theory about life that says we're all in one of about three places. We're either in the midst of some kind of struggle or a storm in our life, or we've just come through one, or we're fixing to go into one. Those difficult times take on lots of different forms, like medical things, struggles in your job, struggles in family relationships and things like that. But because of Christ, we can face those things differently than other people do. You know, when we take the time to invest in other people's lives and we walk through things together with them, when we walk through a difficult time and we face that with Christ in our life, they can observe that in us and they see that it makes a difference in how we react when struggles come and when difficult days come up against us. This is why I react the way I react, because of what Jesus has done for me, because he's walked me through these other times. I know he's going to walk me through this one as well. And so in those relationships, we have a chance to be a testimony and to be an example that the struggles, the fears we face, don't overcome us and don't wipe us out, because we know God is with us. So that part of a transforming relationship is being a witness to other people and sharing with them why we react the way we react, why we do the things we do, and that God wants to help them through those situations just as much as he helps us through it.
Good to see y'all this morning, and again, thank you for Robert. Thank you, Robert, for that song. It ties in really well with what we're talking about in this series. I want to say a quick couple of things before we get into the Word today. First of all, if you haven't yet bought your tickets to our two big events this week, we have a ladies' night out with Jan Dravecki on Tuesday night, and our sports banquet Thursday night features her husband, Dave Dravecki, and both of those people have incredible stories. So if you haven't bought your tickets yet, you can buy them in the what's that area? Oh yeah, the atrium. Yeah, out there. And these would be great events to buy an extra ticket to bring someone along. Somebody who's not a believer, they're going to hear the gospel, or someone who's gone through times of discouragement, times of doubt. These are testimonies that are solid. This is not going to be someone just getting up and telling stories about the old days in baseball. This is going to be deep, serious content that has to do with how God gets you through incredible obstacles and things that threaten to take you down. So I hope you'll take advantage of this opportunity. Secondly, if you are a teacher, private or public, and you're heading back to school this week, I'd like for you to stand right now so I can pray for you. All right. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, we just lift up our teachers all across our community, but especially those who are members of our church. I pray, Lord, that you would equip them, protect them, provide for them in every way. Encourage them, O Lord, as there are so many things that seek to discourage them from the good work that they do. I pray that this would be a wonderful academic year, and a year in which these teachers see the good that they are doing for you, and that they see how you are using them in their community. And help us, O Lord, to encourage them in every way. Lord, we lift these things before you in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, so we are in Revelation chapter 2, verses 8 through 11 this morning. I've been with you guys for about 6.5 years, and I've saved a couple of my favorite stories this long. I can't believe I've done it, but I've done it, and I'm going to tell you one right now. So this one has to do with a friend of mine that I met in seminary whose name is Alan. Not Alan Armstrong, because when I was in seminary, Alan Armstrong was in elementary school in Sulphur Springs. So this guy, the best way I can describe him, back when I knew him at least, picture, if you can picture Jim Carrey, the comedian, when he was in his 20s, except give him an East Texas accent and get him saved, that's my friend Alan. Just personality and physically, that's what he resembled. And he was one of these guys that got saved when he was a teenager, and just the Lord took over his life, and he knew immediately he wanted to serve God in ministry. So as a college student, he went to be the youth minister at a little church, I believe in Tyler or somewhere in that vicinity. And so here he is, this 19, 20-year-old kid, and one day he's taking his youth group to Six Flags Over Texas in Arlington. Now, everything's going fine, except there's this one little kid that he notices that won't ride any rides. And he happens to be a junior high boy, and this kid is awkward even by junior high boy standards. And so doesn't really have any friends. And so Alan feels bad for him. He doesn't want him to have a bad time. And so he goes and he says, "Hey, buddy, how come you're not writing anything?" And he says, "Oh, don't worry about it. I'm having fun." He says, "I know, but why aren't you writing anything?" And the kid says, "Well, because I'm afraid I'll die." He said, "Well, that's silly. Don't worry. You're not going to die at Six Flags, I promise you." And the kid, "Yeah, okay," but he still won't ride anything. And so Alan makes it his mission in life. "I'm going to get this kid on a ride. I'm going to make sure he has a good time today." And slowly over time, he wears him down with just cold, hard logic. First of all, he says, "I will ride with you. I'm not going to risk my life for nothing. So if I get on it, you know that it's safe." And then he says, "You know, people who run this place, this is their livelihood. Don't you think they know that if someone were to die on one of their rides, it would kill their business and they'd lose everything? So don't you think they take extra care to make sure that everything is completely safe?" And then he says, "Have you heard about anybody dying at Six Flags Over Texas?" "Of course not, because everything is inspected. Everything is perfectly safe." And finally the kid says, "Okay, I'll ride something. Now, I don't know what it was called at Six Flags, but back when there was an Astroworld, there was a ride called the Sky Screamer. Some of you may remember this. The Sky Screamer was basically a metal cage that could seat two people. And you would sit down in this cage and they would lock you in, and then they would take you on this track and you would go straight up. Not like tilted up, but straight up. Up, 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 click, 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 as high as you can possibly imagine. And you get to the top and then they extend you out over the chasm of space and you hang there for a few seconds and then you hear this series of beeps. Beep, 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 and down you go, just straight down. And at the last second, it swoops you off onto a track and you stop. Now, I don't know what it was called, but they had a similar ride at Six Flags, and that's the ride this kid chose. You know, go big or go home, I guess. So they get in line, and they're waiting in line in the 110-degree heat of Arlington, Texas in the summertime. And Alan's trying to distract the kid. He's talking. He's telling stories. Like I said, he's a really funny guy. He's trying to keep the kid laughing. As they get up to the front of the line, the kid starts to turn white. They get into the cage, they lock the cage, and now he's starting to tremble. And Alan's thinking, okay, what am I going to do? And so as they're going up, click, 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 they're looking around, and Alan sees, wow, this is a lot higher than I remembered. And then he's like, you know, I think I can see my house in Tyler, you know. And they get to the top, and Alan says, "You're okay, right? This is going to be fun, right?" And the kid said, "Yeah, I hope I don't die." And Alan says, "Well, listen, I never want to hear you say that again. You are not going to die." And the kid says, "Yeah, I guess. It's just that, you know, I was born with this heart defect, and I've had like four or five surgeries." And Alan stares at him, and right then they extend the cage out over the chasm of space. And Alan looks at the kid and realizes he's not joking, and he starts to yell, and he's like, "Hey, hey, hey, somebody get us out of here. This kid's going to die." And right then, beep, 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 down they went. And they're just screaming the whole way down. I mean, Alan said he screamed like an 8-year-old girl. I mean, the whole way down. And they get to the bottom, and they get out, and he feels like his body is turned to jelly. You know how you just, all your bones are gone, and you can barely. And they get out, and the kid looks at him, and he says, "Let's do that again." So, can you believe I waited 6.5 years to tell you that story? So you may know this, but the most common command in Scripture is fear not. It's don't be afraid. It's what God told Moses before he went to confront Pharaoh. It's what Isaiah told King Hezekiah when his nation, when the city of Jerusalem was surrounded by the Assyrians. It's what the angels said to the shepherds on the night of Jesus' birth. And here in the second of the seven letters of Revelation, it's what Jesus says to a church in modern-day Turkey 2,000 years ago. We're going to talk today about what it means to fear not and what it doesn't mean, and especially what it means not just to you as individuals, but us as a church, because like most of the commands in the New Testament, this one is written to a church, to a group, not to an individual. So let's look at verse 8 of Revelation 2. "And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write the words of the first and the last who died and came to life. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich, and the slander of those who say that they are Jews, and they are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. So this letter is written to a church in a town called Smyrna. It's actually a very large city for its time. It was around 200,000 people in the first century. It was a very wealthy city for its time, and it was known for its extreme loyalty to the empire. Just as an example, in 23 AD, during the lifetime of Jesus, they received permission from Rome to build a temple dedicated to the worship of Tiberius Caesar, the emperor at the time. Now, emperor worship was the law in Rome. Every Roman citizen was required once a year to go into a temple and to burn a sacrifice to the emperor himself, to worship him as a god once a year. For most Romans, this was no big deal. This was just an act of patriotism. It's like if you and I were to pledge allegiance to the flag or stand when we hear the national anthem. But for Christians, this was a non-starter. You don't bow before anything other than Jesus. You don't burn a sacrifice to anything. You don't stand. You don't offer your allegiance to anything but Jesus. And through many parts of the empire, Christians could abstain from worshiping the emperor and still be okay, because the standards were a little more lax. But in Smyrna, where people were hyper-patriotic, the Christian community there was seen as suspect. They were seen as traitors to the nation. And you know that anytime anything bad happened in or around that area, people said it's those Christians because they won't worship our emperor. And so there were three things that Jesus pointed out in his letter that the Smyrnan Christians were going through. First of all, he says you're going through tribulation. He's no specifics, but you're going through a time of trouble. He says, secondly, you're going through a time of poverty. And maybe that poverty was because of discrimination, because the Greeks would not, the Romans would not worship or would not do business with Christians. Maybe they wouldn't hire any of the Christian laborers to work on their farms or in their businesses. Maybe they wouldn't do business with any of the Christian businessmen. And so they were struggling financially. But then third, he mentions specifically, they were going through a time of slander. They were being slandered by what Jesus calls a synagogue of Satan. Now, something you need to understand is that in that time at least, it changed later on, but in that time at least, Jews throughout the empire were seen as a protected minority. The Roman Empire, for all their flaws, they were smart enough to see, okay, the Jews are a small group, and we're better off just letting them do their thing. Let them worship their God. Don't enforce our laws about having to sacrifice to the emperor, because they won't cause us any trouble if we just leave them alone. So the Jews were a protected minority, but I would imagine that they saw the Christians as a threat, because here's this new group that claims that one of our own people who got crucified by the Romans is actually Messiah. What if the Romans think that we're like them and they start to crack down on us? So let's do everything we can to differentiate ourselves from this new sect, this new group of Christians. And so they were slandering the Christians. They were saying false things about them to the Roman authorities, and that was causing even more persecution. And so Jesus' verdict in verse 10 is, do not fear. Yes, you're going through tribulation. Yes, you're being slandered. Yes, you are impoverished. But don't be afraid. I've got you. Now, I want to say what this doesn't mean. I want to tell you what this doesn't mean. When the Bible says, do not fear or fear not, it doesn't have anything to do with the emotion of fear you feel. I've been a Christian. I've been in church all my life. I've been a Christian since I was 9. And I've known a whole lot of people, especially a lot of faithful women, who beat themselves up because they were worriers. And they said, I must just not have strong faith, because I feel this worry, because I feel this fear, because I feel this anxiety. This has nothing to do with what you feel. I know this for two reasons. Number one, God knows you can't control how you feel. If you hit your thumb with a hammer tomorrow and you are angry about that, you're not a sinner for being angry about hitting your thumb with a hammer. Okay? Or if somebody cuts you off in traffic, or if somebody insults you. You're not a sinner for feeling that anger. What you're a sinner for is if you take that anger and do something sinful with it, right? And it's the same with fear. You can't control the emotions you feel. All you can control is how you respond to them. And there's a second reason I know that feeling afraid is not a sin, and that is because of what we see in Jesus Christ himself just hours before his own arrest and trial and crucifixion. You read that story in the Gospels of what happens in the Garden of Gethsemane. It's one of the most remarkable stories that's ever been written. There's nothing like it in any other religion. There's no other God who ever experiences the emotions that Jesus went through in Gethsemane, because no other God is real. Jesus is the one true God. He became a man, and as a man, he had real human emotions. And as the clock was ticking down to the time when he would face hell on earth, he felt the fear of it. And he got down on his face. After asking his best friends to pray for him, he got down on his face and he prayed, "Oh God, oh Father, if there's some way to get me through this, if there's some way that I can avoid this, I pray that you would provide it. You know me, Lord. You know that I will do whatever you say. Your will be done and not my own. But if there's a way I can save the world without drinking the cup of your wrath, then provide it." And he was under so much anxiety, the scriptures tell us that the capillaries under his skin literally burst and he began to sweat blood. And none of us has ever experienced stress or fear like Jesus experienced at that moment. And yet he was the greatest man who ever lived and was without sin. So it is not a sin to feel fear. If you are beating yourself up because sometimes when your kids are out late at night, you worry that they may not be safe, or because you've got a doctor's appointment coming up and you don't know what that doctor's going to say and you're worried about it, or your company's downsizing, you're afraid you might get that pink slip and you're worried and you can't sleep and you can't eat, that does not make you a sinner. If you're someone who takes medication for anxiety, that does not make you a person of weak faith. None of what you feel is sin. It's what you do with what you feel. You see? Do not fear. Here's what it means. Because later on in the same verse, or in the same passage, he says, actually the same verse, he says, but be faithful. Be faithful. Be afraid, sure. Fear is natural. But be faithful in your fear. Don't let fear stop you from doing what you know to be the right thing. See, that's where sin comes in, when fear overwhelms us and stops us from doing the will of God. And that's his instruction to the church in Smyrna and to us today. So I want you, I know this is to us as a whole church family, but I want us to ask ourselves individually, what is my worst fear? And I don't mean spiders or clowns or heights or, you know, sitting in a sermon that lasts too long. I don't mean phobias. I mean, what is something that stops you from doing the will of God? To put it another way, what is something good you would do if you weren't so afraid? I want to throw some hypothetical examples up there, because several of these are ones that I have struggled with in the past and sometimes still struggle with, and some of them are things that friends of mine have struggled with. So first of all, here's one. Here's an example. I would have a difficult conversation with someone I know and love who is making bad choices. There are hard conversations that each one of us have to have at periods in our lives. We're called upon to confront, to speak truth in love, but we put it off, or we think someone else will do it. Why? Because we're afraid that person may be angry with me. That person may never speak to me again. That person may think that I'm judgmental or harsh, and I may lose a friend. Don't let fear stop you from doing what is right. Here's another one. I would trust God with my finances. And I don't know, you know, this is not me talking out of a position of, oh, we're in trouble financially. The truth is our church is doing really well financially, and it's thanks to God's generosity through your generosity, and I'm thankful for that. But I don't know who gives what. It could be that five people in this room do all the giving and everybody else is just sitting around on their hands. I don't know. My point is not that we need more as a church, because we don't. We're doing fine. My point is that if you are not serving God with your resources, whether you make $20,000 a year or $2 million a year, if you're not serving God with your resources, then you are missing the obedience that leads to victory and joy and freedom in your life. And if you're letting fear stop you, if you're letting this idea that I can't be generous because then I may not be able to live to the best of my abilities. I may not be able to afford the things that I need, that I think my family needs. Don't let fear stop you. Here's another one. I would pursue transforming relationships. We talk about this all the time. And I know many of you are engaged in these kinds of relationships with Christians and non-Christians, but I'm sure there are others who feel held back because you think to yourself, yeah, but if I get involved, if I invest in this person's life, what if they reject me? What if they see me as one of those crazy religious nuts? Or there's the other fear, I don't know that I have the time to get involved with somebody else. I'm afraid of what will happen. It may take away all my free time that I enjoy doing this thing, this hobby that's my thing. I don't want to offer God my relationships. He can have my Sunday mornings. He can have my language. He can have a few areas of my life, but not that. Don't let fear stop you from reaching out to the people that God put you on earth to reach. And here's another one. I would treat with kindness and love people who are aggressively hateful. There are many of us, I'm sure, that are afraid that if we're kind to somebody who's a jerk, that then people will start to see us as soft. That if we forgive people who've hurt us, then people will think, well, now I can take advantage of her. I can push him around. We like for others to fear us. We like to be seen as someone who's a little bit volatile, a little bit dangerous. We're afraid of what will happen if we obey the command of God to love our enemies and to pray for those who hate us and to forgive those who've hurt us in the way that Christ has forgiven us. There's another one. I would offer Jesus full obedience. What if I write God a blank check with my life and then he sends me someplace that I don't want to go? What if he sends me north of the Arctic Circle and I hate cold weather? What if he makes me give up all my possessions? What if he makes me... We're afraid. We offer God conditional obedience. We're content to be junior varsity Christians, which doesn't actually exist in the scriptures. And then there's a last one. I would stop letting worry steal my joy. You know, earlier I said don't beat yourself up for feeling worry, but if you let worry and fear steal your joy, I'm not talking about those crisis moments where suddenly something happens, the emotional equivalent of hitting your thumb with a hammer, right? When there's a crisis that occurs and you're afraid of what's going to happen next, there's nothing wrong with that. But if every single day you've got something you're chewing on, something you're worrying about. And that's some of us. There are some of us, if you were honest, you would say, I'm never really happy unless I've got something that I'm worried about. Right? In fact, I can't rest at night if I don't know what I should be worrying about. Because I have this fear that if I don't worry about it, it might take me by surprise. Instead of just trusting that God knows and God sees and he's walking ahead of you. He's got the light and he's got the power. Do you let worry and fear steal your joy? See, those are just a few examples that I could think of. Your greatest fear may be something else entirely. My point is, identify it today. Whatever it is. Whatever that fear is that's stopping you from doing the will of God, from experiencing abundant life, from blessing others, from glorifying him, identify it, confess it, and just tell God, Lord, help me to do what is right. Teach me the courage to do the right thing. Jesus, and I have to say this, this is not going to help you, but I've got to say it because it's biblical. He never says, your fears are unfounded, you've got nothing to worry about. He's not Alan, my friend Alan with the little kid. You're not going to die, you're going to be fine. He's not saying that. In fact, he says the opposite to the church at Smyrna. He says, some of you are going to be arrested. You're going to go to jail for 10 days. And it's even worse than it sounds to us because remember, in the ancient world, jails were not places of punishment. They were places to hold you until your trial. Your punishment was never to sit in jail for a certain amount of time. The jail was there until you were tried, convicted, and executed or set free. Notice Jesus doesn't say what happens at the end of the 10 days. And it could be that these Christians are going to die. We know this is the period when the book of Revelation is written, is a time when the Roman Empire, in a way it never had before, began to crack down on the Christian faith. And martyrdom became something that was very, very real. He says, be faithful unto death. The very thing you most fear may actually take place. The friend you confront may hate you for it, may never speak to you again. The enemy you start treating with kindness may stab you in the back. The poor person you choose to help with your resources, you may find out later they were a scam artist who took advantage of you. Jesus doesn't promise us that if we just are sincere and obedient, everything will work out perfectly. He in fact says, it's okay. It's okay to follow me through the valley of the shadow of death. In fact, I will lead you there. I will lead you there, and I will lead you through it, but you have to trust me. But there is reassurance in this instruction. He says, you think you're poor, but you're actually rich. You know where fear comes from? Fear comes from a poverty mindset. Fear comes from a mindset that says, if I risk anything, I could lose everything. I better just hold on to what I have. But if the one we worship owns all things, then we're not risking anything, are we? Everything we risk, he's got it in spades and he can give it back to us. He can bless us. He can show us the way. He promises us the crown of life. He promises us in this instruction to the church at Smyrna, you will not be hurt by the second death. You know, this is another way of saying the worst thing they can do is kill you, and that's a promotion. What are you worried about? You worry they're going to kill you? That's good news for you. That may be the best thing that ever happened to you. So don't be afraid. Don't let fear stop you from doing the will of God. You know, eventually Christians took hold of that promise, and some actually began to pray that God would allow them to be martyrs. I'm not saying we should be that bold, but I am saying that we should be like those three boys in the book of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who stood in front of the most powerful man on earth, Nebuchadnezzar, could feel the heat from the furnace nearby that they were about to be tossed into, and said, O king, we know that our God can rescue us from this fire, if he wants to, but even if he does not, we will not bow. That's the courage I'm talking about. It's not the false faith that says, because I claim it, God will do it. No, it's a faith that says, I don't know what God's going to do. God's going to do the right thing, whatever that is. And whatever that is, I trust him, and I'm going to go with him, even if it's harder, because I know in the end, that's the right path. Now, I have prayed for courage almost every day for the past 30 years or so, ever since I went into the ministry. And so... there's a verse that's become very, very important to me. It's Proverbs 28:1. And I'm not as good at scripture memory as I should be as a pastor, but this is one I have memorized. The wicked flee, though no one pursues, but the righteous are as bold as a lion. And what that tells me is, as I grow in the Lord, as I grow in righteousness, I should grow in courage. And you should too. Courage is not something that we just get when we pray for it. We don't just pray and the next day we wake up and we're like John Wayne in one of those westerns, right? Just wade into the gunfire without fear. No, courage comes when we do what's hard. Courage comes as we grow in Christ, and we grow in Christ through obedience. So when I was 21 years old, newly married, that's when I felt God's call to go into ministry. Now, that's a whole other story of how that happened, but I want to tell you, I was terrified. It was about this time of year. We got married at the end of May, and it was late July, early August, and I felt convinced that I was called to ministry, and I was terrified to tell my young wife, because that's really a lousy thing to do to a young woman, right? That is kind of the ultimate bait and switch. Hey, thanks for marrying me. Now you're going to be impoverished. Now you're going to live in a glass house the rest of your life. Hey, you're a preacher's wife, like it or not. And I told her. I could have just said, okay, I'm walking away from this. I can't do this. But I told her, and she said, I've always felt called to be, or at least since I was a teenager, felt called to marry someone going into ministry, to support someone who is serving the Lord full time. I knew God would call you someday, I just didn't know when it would be. Now, you talk about confirmation, that's something I needed to hear. But I wasn't out of the woods yet. Now I had to tell her parents. And you laugh, but Carrie's parents, although very, very devout and good and godly people, Carrie's dad was a successful man. I mean, he had been a chemical engineer. He'd run refineries. He'd been a higher up in a couple of different energy companies. And so he provided well for his family. And so I was about to tell him, you know, your daughter's going to be pretty poor for the next couple of decades. And not only is she going to live in a glass house, at times that glass house is going to have wheels under it, and it's going to be single wide, you know, in the bad part of town, and or not even the town, you know, out there where you can hear the banjos playing in the woods and all that kind of stuff. And you think I'm exaggerating, but I'm not. And I can remember the day, it was a Sunday after church, when we had them over to our little apartment to tell them the news. And Carrie made a roast, and Carrie makes really good roast, and yet I couldn't even touch it. I couldn't eat it. I was just terrified. But I told them, and they said, well, you know, I don't know why you're afraid. We're thrilled to support anybody who's going to serve the Lord with their life. And I was like, okay, hallelujah. And then came the day, and this was several months later, because it was May of 93. It was Mother's Day of 93 when my home church asked me to preach for the very first time I ever preached a sermon. And I pulled out the sermon notes a few years ago. I found them somewhere, and it made me laugh out loud because I think I had 20 points. I think my goal must have been, I'm going to say everything I know about God in one sermon, and yet I was so nervous I said it in about 8 minutes. But I remember getting there, and you know, I grew up in a very small church, and I'd kind of said to myself, this is going to be fine. These are all just people who know you and love you. And I walked in, and there was a guy there who I'd gone to high school with who wasn't a member of the church, and he wasn't supposed to be there. That just threw me off completely. I'd pictured everybody in the pews in my mind, but this guy showed up because he was dating one of the girls that I grew up with, and they later got married, and he comes and he goes, hey, Jeff, how you doing? You still living in Houston? Yeah, I am. And that just messed me up. I was terrified. In fact, at that moment, I thought, you know, I could just get in the car and drive away. Everybody here loves me. They'd forgive me. There was this internal monologue that was saying, what are you doing? You're not a preacher. What are you doing? Who are you fooling? But I got up behind that pulpit, and I thought your knees shaking was a cliche, but it was really happening. And I delivered that sermon. And I think back on that, and I think about how now Sunday mornings are my favorite time of the week. And I'm not afraid to get up and preach. Why? Well, for one thing, because I faced that fear, because I did what God told me to do in spite of the fact that I didn't want to do it. And that's my point to you, is whatever you're afraid of, you overcome it not by waiting for courage to come upon you. You overcome it by facing it, by doing what God told you to do. And the longer you put it off, the harder it is. You do it today. You do it now. You do it before you go to bed tonight. You make the phone call. You set up the meeting with that person you need to talk to. You write that check. You open your Bible and start studying. You have that conversation this afternoon. Or at the very least, you tell a trusted friend today in life group or later on, listen, this is what I'm afraid of. I just need to confess this between you and me. This is what's holding me back. Pray for me and hold me accountable. Ask me every week if I've done the right thing yet. Remember the courage of Jesus in the garden. Father, not my will, but yours be done. If anybody ever had an excuse to give in to fear and walk away, it was him. No one would have judged him. He owed us nothing. When you lack courage, pray to the one who took the nails for you, in spite of all the fear. Pray to the one who showed the ultimate courage, and he will lead you in the direction you need to go. He will make you as bold as a lion. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we want to be that kind of church, the kind of church that produces men and women of courage and faith, men and women who do what is right, who speak the truth in love, who take risks for you when you command it, and who do not back down. I pray that we would be those kinds of people by your grace. Lord, make us that kind of church that produces those kinds of people. Help us to encourage one another. Lord, we lift these things before you in the name of Jesus, by his power, and for his sake. Amen. So I haven't done this in a long time. I did it last week at the 11:15 service, but I'm going to do it here today. And that is, I'm going to stand in front. We'll still have our next steps area if you want to join the church this morning. If you want to talk to somebody in a quiet place afterwards, you can go to the next steps area across the atrium. But right now, I want to give you the opportunity if you want to respond to what God is saying. And this is a way for your whole church family to know, I need to pray for this person. You may just want to come and pray at the altar over something that's going on in your life. You may want to come pray with me. You may want to come and say, it's time for me to take a step of courage and follow the Lord or do something He's called me to do. But while we sing these next few songs, I'm going to be standing right here ready to receive you if you're led to. We're going to sing a song, start with the song, Wherever He Leads, I'll Go. It's a perfect way. Let's sing that to the Lord. Stand, and you come if God's calling.
Take up thy cross and follow me. I heard my Master say, I gave my life to ransom thee. Surrender your all today. Wherever He leads, I'll go. Precious bleeding side. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Oh, the pure delight of a single hour that before thy throne I spend. When I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. And there are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea. And there are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Because ye live,
July.
July is over now and August starts tomorrow, and it's the beginning of what I'm going to be calling Dravecki Week, because next week we have two great speakers, Jan Dravecki and Dave Dravecki, and they'll be speaking. Jan will be here at the Ladies Night Out event on August 2nd, that's Tuesday, and Dave will be here on August 4th at the Outdoor and Sports Banquet, that's Thursday. So make sure you drop by the atrium and pick up your tickets for that event, because it's going to be awesome. If you don't know anything about them, Dave used to pitch for the San Francisco Giants, but he lost his arm due to cancer, and obviously that had an impact on their family, and they asked questions, you know, what am I going to do now? Why would God let this happen? They actually started a ministry called Endurance where they answer some of those questions, and they're going to be talking about topics very similar to that next week, so come to one of those events. It could literally change your life. Now, tonight we have the Family Fun Night at the Conroe Aquatic Center. That starts at 6:30, so come on out, dive in the pool, eat some pizza, drink some sodas. It's going to be a good time. With all that being said, we'll see you next week. Okay, bye.